I'm good. How are you this morning? Am I calling you too early?
No, it's all right. I was expecting you to call me this morning. That's good. It's all good.
Yeah. Well, if it's okay, I'm just recording us again, just so.
No problem.
Just so I have something to listen to.
Yeah, no, no problem at all. I'm recording you too, so I can send it to Chris and let him listen to it. So,
all
right. Fair is fair, right?
Yeah.
Cool. Okay. Did you get my email that I think I sent it. I don't remember. It was kind of late.
No, you did. I didn't get an email in the past day or so.
All right. I'll let you guide the conversation, and I guess since you're the expert on this. But there's a lot of things that I feel like that I ran by Ed that I feel like that might be, helpful to which if y'all go at a certain angle. I'm not sure how y'all do this. I'm really interested in finding out how y'all, this whole thing unfolds. But I guess the question I want to ask is, do you ever go into the courts and hold a judge or the prosecutors when they have completely violated a defendant, and there's actually Supreme Court rulings showing that if certain violations by the judges, if this happens, that the government reverses the conviction. Have you ever heard of anything like that happening?
I know Ed. Again, I'm a little bit more experienced on the court side of it. I know Ed just has a lot of experience in that.
Yeah.
In that respect. I mean, my gut feeling, I would say yes, having read a lot of the cases. And we already pretty much know how we want to proceed on this one, or Ed does, so...
Okay, cool.
And that's what we're going to kind of pursue. So, whatever new information or that you think might be helpful,
well,
I would sure like to hear it.
Well, I have a lot, I sent so much to you guys, I'm not sure if I sent you got all the recordings from the different people, is that right?
You mean the things on YouTube?
No. Well, actually, one of them might be on YouTube. This is I had recorded the sheriff, and I had recorded a prosecutor at one time. The prosecutor.
I don't remember seeing those. I saw some, unless it's just some links that I missed.
No, maybe I didn't send them. The FBI agent Ken Western, that was on YouTube. You probably heard that one.
Yeah, I did. I listened to that. I also listened to some things from Charles himself.
He's a good guy, isn't he?
As well.
Can you tell he's a good guy, Charles?
Well, not from that. I mostly know that he's. I don't know if he's a quote good guy or not, but. I know that he's innocent in this particular case of the child, the sex abuse allegation.
Right.
So that's all I can say. I'll probably get to know him a little bit better, I guess, as we continue to proceed on this.
How corrupt? I mean, just from your expert, I'm just kind of curious. What level of corruption of setting this guy up? I mean, what level do you think this is at? Like, how deep do you think it really goes?
I'm still really not sure yet. I mean, there's a lot of accusations against, I guess, the FBI, and I guess I need to see a motive for that. It might be to, like you said, to infiltrate these militia groups. Why they targeted Charles, I guess maybe because he was a primary spokesman.
Right.
For anti-government things. We'd like to probably do is maybe try to get some evidence along those lines.
Well, this is what my stance has always been with the FBI, because they have affected my life as well. I can send you, copies of screenshots if you want them, of the news. I mean, every news media from ABC to NBC, all of the big ones, they were calling him a Timothy McVeigh militia member this is from the very beginning. That right there is concerning. They're creating an image of him that was, that was not, had nothing to do with a charge of raping a child. But they got that information somehow, to report him as a Timothy McVeigh militia member. And then they had that 12-state manhunt with the FBI, was very much involved. with the manhunt that they called on him when he did not show up for his court date for the state charge. So that right there is really concerning. That shows the federal, that oversteps jurisdiction, I believe, with the federal government, and that would be the responsibility of the sheriff in that county, and also, I believe, I guess, the judge for allowing the feds to come in and violate and overstep their, there's like jurisdictional, I believe, jurisdictional rules that you have to, that the feds are supposed to abide by, and if they overstep into a, you know, a state situation, then I believe that they can actually, I think that might be one of the reasons that you can actually have the government reverse a charge. Because the feds have been involved this entire time. I mean, really involved. And that one agent that we uncovered as being a undercover, he was working with the FBI. Did you ever get to listen to that one? The one with that he actually admits working with the FBI against Charles?
Are you talking about with Gene Poole?
No, that's another FBI. He's from the Weapons of Mass Destruction Department of Washington. No, this is one of the guys, Darren Wilburn. He's actually been involved. He's the one that got the attorney for Charles. And Darren Wilburn and his girlfriend, Amelia, they are very connected to the feds. They work with the feds. And Darren, during one of these conversations I had with him, he actually slipped during the conversation and claimed to be working with the FBI. Hunting Charles. This is during the manhunt. And so he didn't realize he slipped, but I called him on it. It's like 37 minutes into our conversation, but you hear him point blatantly, say straight out that the local office there that he was working with, and he totally admits working with the FBI. So I don't know if that would help or not, but when you find out that he's working with the FBI, but he was acting undercover, and then you find out he's the one that found the attorney for Charles, who didn't do anything for Charles, you start seeing the federal setup, the federal involvement, all throughout his support group. So, is there any way we can...
I have to kind of remind you, and this is what Ed has said, too. You know, our primary thing is to get Charles... out of jail,
yeah,
and get the conviction overturned. That's our primary thing right now.
Right.
And I think most of that hinges on the sex abuse case.
Does it really? You have enough to get him to... That's amazing, then. That'll be great.
Well, not yet, but that's why we're going to be going out there. I understand that. I guess last night, sounds like Chris wired the balance of
yeah.
The
5,000?
Yeah, of the retainer, so which we needed to be able to pay for some expenses for going out there, because both Ed and I will go out there.
Yeah, I think Amy and I are going to come out there with you guys. We're going to head out there, too. So.
And I told Amy I was going to let her know, and Jan as well, so, and you, too.
Cool.
So I'll let you know the dates and everything, and I'll be talking to Ed after I talk with you this morning.
Okay, there was something else I wanted to bring up to you. We have a possible lead. I'm not sure what kind of access you guys have to records, but now this person claims that he can get them. I'll know in 24 hours, but there's also, not to go back to the feds again, but there's direct payments that have been made to one of these support guys. It's Rick Light. Rick Light is one of the, I call him one of the bad guys. But he's actually been paid three different payments from the FBI to himself. Yeah, one for $15,000 and then two different payments for $8,000.
Okay, and you'll have some records to back that up?
I'm hoping so, yeah. This person told me that he can, is that going to help? Would you like to have those?
Oh, yeah, well, we'd like to have, absolutely everything.
Okay.
That you have.
Okay. Because can you go into, I'm not sure how I guess dangerous this could be for, I'm so stuck on the FBI being involved in this. That's just my whole, stance I'm taking. It's completely against his rights and everyone involved. So with this, if this really is hypothetically a setup with the feds involved, setting Charles up, which I believe that it has been, and you have proof to show the FBI agent that's been, I guess, the ringleader over this whole charade, which is Ken Western, if you have proof to show, hey, we are now able to uncover or expose your entire little network that's been setting Charles up. Would that be a good bartering tool, possibly? To the point to where he might help, you know, have these charges reversed? You know what I'm trying to say? To where he doesn't want to get...
Yeah, I do. I guess they would, well, our primary thing that we're trying to do right now is we're trying to gather new evidence,
on the child?
For a new trial, not a retrial, but a completely new trial that'll get Charles off. So some of these things may help.
Because see, there's...
I'm not sure if they will directly help at this point or not, but just to have everything that we can have that I can look at with Ed.
Okay.
And then we can, you know, make that decision.
Okay, because I'm stuck on this whole thing. I mean, a new trial sounds great, but it just seems like his rights have been so violated, and that there's rules of, like, there's judicial misconduct. There's, like, judges have their rules, and the prosecutor has his rules of the court. And when these rules are not followed, supposedly, I mean, they're really, really strict if you are able to push these, you know, push it through to the point to where if Charles's rights are violated, like through his habeas corpus and his rights to a fair trial, he's already had four trials, and he's never had a fair one. And so his rights, I mean, just from like the very first time his trial happened and the district attorney lied about the DNA evidence and did not present it honestly to show to the jury what it really said. I mean, completely lied about the results of this report. That one violation alone is enough to have the entire thing reversed and the charges get dropped, if I'm reading this correctly.
Yeah.
So to where there shouldn't have even been a trial. You see what I'm saying? So,
Yeah. Well, I know there's been a lot of things. I haven't been able to see any of the court records from anything but the very first trial.
Oh, you haven't?
I've been told they're not available yet.
Oh, the ones from the most recent one? Yeah, they're trying to say, see, this is one of those screwy things that is also against, I'm sure somewhere there's a rule that they're not supposed to do this. But I guess while we're out there, if we don't have them yet, we can just go inside the courthouse and probably get them, can't we?
Yeah, that's what we'll probably do.
Shouldn't the attorney hand them over, his attorney? Doesn't he have isn't he required to hand over Charles's file if he has, you know, since he's no longer the attorney? You'd think that he would have to.
Yeah, and that's probably a question for Ed as well. I know that I guess his latest lawyer, Hope.
Yes, he's horrible. Yeah.
It sounds like he hasn't been real cooperative, and I know you had some ideas. Was it Daryl Wilburn that you said helped secure this?
Yeah.
Attorney.
Yeah. Darren will.
I got something from Amy, I think, asking me to get Hoke to do something there. I don't remember what it was now.
Yeah, Hoke is Hoke was the sales pitch that he gave Mrs. Dyer to get, because there were six attorneys that were brought to her by her support group. Okay, and Darren and Amelia recommended Hoke. And Hoke supposedly had some big award, and supposedly what he told Mrs. Dyer, which was a lie, he said he was a Marine. I can't find any records on this man ever serving in the military. But he also told Mrs. Dyer that his normal fee was $250,000 for this kind of case, but he was going to go ahead and only charge her $30,000 since he's a Marine and since Charles is a Marine and since he believes Charles is innocent. So that was the sales pitch that Mrs. Dyer caught on to, and she was very, very excited about this attorney. And it's really sad because, you know, the bad guys, the undercover Fed, the one that got this attorney for Charles. So right there, it just shows more. I mean, to me, it just shows this setup. You know, this whole thing was a setup. You know, and so I guess for some reason, this whole time though, no one's talked about the federal involvement. I don't know if that's dangerous to talk about it publicly or maybe that's the reason why he hasn't been found, you know, because if he has another trial and if the jury can hear all this extra stuff that's been done to him, like all the threats, I mean, he was threatened by, he was offered a deal, like Agent Gene Poole came down from Washington and pulled Charles aside and told him that they can make all this go away if he would be willing to follow this list of objectives that he gave Charles to look at and infiltrate the militia movement for 2 years. Basically, work for him for 2 years, they can make all this go away. And he told her, he said, F you. He said, no, I'm not doing it. So, I mean, they wanted him to infiltrate the militia and the Patriot movement and collect information or whatever was on that list, but he refused it. And then they told Mrs. Dyer the same thing. They told Mrs. Dyer that if she doesn't cooperate, that they're gonna stack up enough charges to make her son go away for 40 years. So this is, I mean, if the jury hears this stuff, it's like, for some reason, everybody told, you know, Mrs. Dyer and Charles not to talk about any of the federal involvement. So it's like, to me, that might be the key component that's missing, because once you start putting the federal information out there and how much threats and how much violations they've done, and it shows that this is a setup. You know, it just shows more to me that this whole entire situation is wrong. You know, it takes the light off of the child, you know, and because we all know he didn't do it, and it puts the light back on showing this guy, you know, being set up, I think. So.
Yeah, and some of those things may come out. Some of them may be separate issues too.
You think?
The primary thing is to get, like I said, I've said it before,
I know.
To get Charles out and to get his sex abuse conviction overturned.
Okay.
And some of these other things may be side things that you'd have to try to accomplish.
All right.
You know, afterwards. You know, I know, you know, it's not, you know, corruption in the government is certainly nothing new anymore.
Right.
Just read the U.S. Observer. You'd have to we can't wage war against the federal government right now. The primary thing is to get Charles out of jail, and once he gets his life squared away, some of the stuff, you know, may come out. And some of it may come out in a new trial as well. I'm just not, you know, not sure how much we would use.
What about
What
about filing suits against each of these people, or these public servants, like the judge? I mean, filing suit against him for, you know, supposedly there's a procedure you do if you're violated. If a judge oversteps his code of ethics and doesn't follow his fiduciary duties that they have, we're supposed to, as the people, hold these people accountable. And so would that be something to possibly think about for Charles? Because I have these things I wrote up. I never sent them in, but it's just I follow the directions on what the, you know, the Oklahoma, district court tells you to do if the judge violates you. And so it's called misdirection of the judge, and this is when things are supposed to be getting reversed. So do you want me to just send them to you and see what you think, and maybe you could, you know, use them for
an angle? Don't file anything right now.
No, I won't.
Sometimes what people do actually can make things worse.
Really?
Make,
that's what Ms. Dyer said.
Difficult.
See, this is what gets me. What gets me is, though, is when a judge is acting bad, basically, then you have another trial that comes up, a mistrial. Then you go in front of the same judge that acted bad the first time. Of course he's going to act bad again. You know, so there's got to be something we can do. I don't know if there's maybe somehow in the future we can come up with a way to fix this, because this is why the courts are so corrupt. You know, it's because these guys are being allowed to act out of their authority. And that's why the corruption is, that's why it's getting more and more corrupt, because they're getting away with it, basically. I mean, for the attorney to walk Charles back into the exact same courtroom with the exact same judge and the exact same DA was just, to me, was insanity. I mean, because why would you think that the judge and the DA was going to act any different during these other trials than he did the first time when they violated his rights then? So to me, that's just like, it just doesn't make any sense. Why didn't he fight for him to have a change of venue or, you know, something? And it just never happened. So all this is a big violation on all these different people. They all kind of go hand in hand. And so I'll send you the Supreme Court ruling that I found that shows, like, if your habeas corpus and if your rights to a fair trial have been completely slandered like this one is, then the government is required to reverse, actually just drop the charges, and there's no conviction. So I'll send it to you and see what you think.
And that's what we're going to try to do, is try to get the conviction overturned and without even having to do a new trial.
That would be amazing.
Some of these legal-type questions will be better asked of Ed
Y'all keep saying back and forth to each other the same thing. I think it's funny.
Okay.
Yeah, he tells me, he says you're the expert in the legal, this part of it, and then you tell him. So it's just kind of funny. But that's cool.
Yeah, he actually is. I'm pretty new to this. I'm mostly the investigative part, learning some of the ropes, to be honest with you. But if it wasn't for that, Ed wouldn't even have taken the case on because they're just so overwhelmed with cases like this.
Really? So this is good then. He's got experience on
it. Yeah, but the good thing is that, you know, he will be, you know, I'm kind of gathering the evidence, talking to the people, and that conversation that you and I had, I sent to him so he could hear it. So you got him involved where otherwise he wouldn't even have taken the case. So
are you serious?
So that's the good news. Well, just because there's only so many hours in a day.
Right.
He turns down, I mean, so many cases all the time just because there isn't time to process.
Well, hey, I'm looking for a job, and I'm good to, I could be trained. I would love to do a job like this. I'm serious.
Well,
I think
it would be. Yeah, that's it. You'd have to talk to Ed about that. You know, sounds like if you can come to Oklahoma when we go, you can meet him. So
I want to see how y'all do this too. What a great thing to do. I mean, it takes some guts, I'm sure, to walk in and to take over. But you know, I already tried to do this last year by myself. I went out when I visited Charles. I actually went to the prosecutor's office, and I had a little tape recorder on me, and I knocked on the door. I wanted to talk to him and find out, you know, get his response on why he actually lied during the last trial, and find out why did he do this, get a response from him and get it recorded. But he wouldn't see me. He refused to talk to me. But
yeah.
I actually went out there and attempted to,
That's where we have the power of the press behind us, because the U.S. Observer is very instrumental in exposing these people, and they don't want to be exposed. As you know, corruption and evil doing is best done in secret and in the dark, and these people don't want exposure. So if you have some time, Deborah, I would encourage you to go on to the U.S. Observer website, read some of the stories in there. You can see what Ed does.
Yeah.
There's a story actually in the paper, but it's also on the website about a Pensacola case about all kinds of corruption.
Really? Cool.
That was going on in Pensacola. He said it's, I guess, Florida. There's a lot of this kind of stuff going on.
Well, these people that are the undercover feds are from Florida. They're out of the Pensacola. The Pensacola feds are the ones that ransacked the home that I was in last year during that manhunt, and they had no warrant, and they had no... They had no rights to do what they did. And I actually called the Pensacola FBI like a week ago to talk to the man by the name of James Stewart. And I find out that's the supervisor over the Pensacola office. And he has never returned my phone call. I was going to record it because I wanted him to respond to me and just see what he has to say about a year later, you know, why he authorized that kind of, you know, forced to happen without a warrant, and I just wanted to get a reaction from him, and he never called me back. But his name is James Stewart out of Pensacola, and he's
Is it James?
No, James. James Stewart.
Oh, James. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
James
Stewart.
What was the last name?
Stewart. Yes. Yeah. Huh. James Stewart. That's correct. That's the number. That's the name that they wrote down. I talked to his secretary. She was really nice. And, but yeah, he never called me back. And that's really unprofessional, because usually the feds always call back, you know, if there's a message.
Yeah.
They usually do. But yeah, he didn't call me back. So I would like to press charges against them. Some sort of lawsuit is what I'm trying to go after eventually. So hopefully.
Yeah. You know, just for the record too, I tried to talk to David Hammond, which was,
the first attorney.
First lawyer, and he didn't return the call, so
yeah.
I don't know if it was you, or maybe Amy told me she thought he might have some possible new evidence for us, but
oh, really? Yeah, I don't think he's gonna, these guys are bought and paid for, they work for the prosecutor. I mean, this whole system is really, in this one area, is very, it's like the good old boys club, you know, they're not gonna...
Yeah.
I don't think they're going to have anything, but there's got to be a way we can get some of this stuff back from the other attorney, like demand it. There's got to be a way to do it, I'm sure. But not to keep you on the phone too long, I guess I'll send you these other recordings I have with the sheriff and the district attorney that I have.
Yeah, do that. Also, I have a question for you too as well, Deborah. I watched one of Charles's videos on YouTube, and he referred to, it looked like he was holding up a flash drive, saying that he had evidence, I think it was evidence against the, I don't remember his name now off the top of my head, the district attorney or the prosecutor.
Right.
Jason in his Hatch. Trial. Is that the evidence? I saw some videos from you as well that you did. Is that the evidence that you have that you think is going to help, you know, blow some of this stuff open?
I would think so. I have to go back. There's so many videos that he and I have both done. I'd have to look at the right time frame. But he's going to be calling me tomorrow, so I can specifically ask him just to make sure. He's going to be calling tomorrow. So, but also, it might have, if that's not what I have, that might have gotten burnt in the fire in the house.
It looked like he was holding up a flash drive, and I know you mentioned you've got evidence that would expose the DA. So I didn't know if that was one and the same thing.
I'll have to go back and look at it. It might be, but it might not. He had a lot of stuff himself that, you know, never got out also. But I can ask him tomorrow and find out.
I guess so.
Okay. Anything else you want me to ask them?
I'm just wondering if we have all the evidence that you guys have, I guess is my main.
Well, I can ask him tomorrow when he calls. Is there anything that you, any leads that y'all need on people to talk to, or, you know, there was a judge that he had mentioned that was on his side, that believes he was innocent. And it's in one of his letters, I believe, It's in his letter that he, I can get the letter to you if you don't already have it. It's the letter that he wrote when he was on the run, and it was like, it's the one that, in the very end of the letter, he says something about, you know, if I'm not home within 90 days, I'm probably dead. I don't know if you read that letter or
no,
not.
No, I didn't.
Oh, you have not read that letter? Okay, well, there's a judge.
That doesn't sound familiar.
Okay, then I'll send that one to you. I mean, have you read any of Charles's own words, like his own outline of everything, all the events as they've unfolded? Have you read any of his own, like, letters he's written?
I've read everything that has been sent to me, so...
Right, okay. That's probably a lot.
and that was actually something that Charles alluded to in one of his videos, where he, I don't remember if it was him that said it, but he said he gave his first lawyer, Hammond, like a three-page letter outlining a lot of stuff. I was actually interested in seeing that.
Okay,
so
three-page letter. I'll
maybe
get
that's the one you're talking about, and I have not read that because I haven't gotten it.
Okay, well then, that might be the one. I think that is the one. He wrote that when he was, after I picked him up. It's like it was his explanation for why he left. Let me see. That's important because he drops a bunch of names in there, and these are people who... believed he was, you know, who was innocent. And there's also, I believe, now he used to work at the place, the jail he's in right now. He actually used to work there. He was an employee there.
Oh, okay.
I don't know if that helps y'all with anything or not, but yeah, he used to be a jailer there at the same county jail. So, and there's some officers, I believe, in the jail that that also had a problem with all these charges too. Maybe that'll help.
Yeah, I've got a couple of those names as well. Amy was going to supply me with some contact information for some people, and she's gotten a couple of things. Maybe what I'll do is I'll send a list of some of the people that I'd like to get contact information for that I don't yet, and see if maybe you can provide some of them as well.
All right. How about go ahead,
Charlie. A couple of more police officers, but one of them, I think, is it a Nathan Cario? That I think was a friend of Charles's when he was at the police department. I think he was one of them. He was supposedly going to be called as a witness and never was.
Right.
Kind of a character witness, I guess.
Right. Did you get the gag order? I mean, I was supposed to send that to you, but my computer, I almost lost all my information on my computer that week. I had to go get everything transferred to a hard drive, external hard drive. I'm glad I didn't lose everything. But you don't have the gag order yet, do you, from the judge?
I don't think so. I know of a gag order, but I don't think I've seen any documentation of it.
Okay, I'll get that to you. So I need the letter, the gag order, the complaints I wrote up, these are just rough drafts, okay? I'm sure they're probably done all wrong, so...
Oh, that's okay. Yeah, no, that's all right.
But
don't spend a lot of time
Well, there's
make
just,
them grammatically correct. Just,
there's good.
As long as they have the information.
Yeah, there's good. Like, I mean, there's good highlights to show you the violations that you know. There's just so many. It's just hard to remember off the top of your head. But this is a good breakdown of what you know, a pretty good amount of things that you could possibly use. You know.
Yeah. Yeah. Exactly. And that's what we want.
Yeah. Okay.
And you never know. Yeah. You never know. You never know what's going to lead you to something that's really going to be useful.
Right. And there's something that I saw interesting is when I looked on the Oklahoma, like the schedule, it shows you all the different court dates and appearances. And at the very top of the page, it says, you know, who the judge is and who the district attorney is. Well, they have a whole different district attorney in that logged as the one that did this trial. And it was Jason Hicks is the district attorney. He was, you know, the one who was performed in the trial, but on this, for some reason, on the Oklahoma, on their records, it says a whole different district attorney's name. I don't know if that matters, but that seems kind of fishy. I'm wondering if there's like a rule in Oklahoma that only so many times, since there were so many mistrials, there was like four of them, and I wonder if there's some sort of rule on the way they run their courts to where a district attorney could possibly only be allowed to do so many mistrials before they have to bring another one in. But see, this is the same district attorney that's been on all of it. So I'm wondering if they, like, slid a different name in there on purpose, you know, are you with me, to cover their own tracks?
Yeah, to make it sound like it's
yeah.
No malfeasance going
yeah.
on. Yeah, it's possible.
Maybe we
I know that there's a lot of connections in Oklahoma. In fact, we're going to be probably meeting with some of those people that could help us with some of this as well. So.
They're good guys?
That are good guys. So that'll help us with this too. Like I said, our primary thing is just to get Charles out of jail and get the conviction overturned. Whether some of this stuff gets exposed at this time, you know, that's kind of not our primary concern. They may be separate issues that you guys may want to pursue afterwards, or you know, if Ed's interested, you know, if you're interested in. You know, paying us to expose some of that stuff again, you know, after we get Charles up. But that's our main thing. I mean, this is a guy who's sitting in jail for something that he didn't do. He was possibly railroaded by, you know, a conspiracy type thing. I don't know what the motivation for that would be.
To the militia.
I'll be honest with you. I've wondered sometimes whether Valerie was possibly had a relationship with somebody in the courts or the police department where they would do things on her behalf that would help her. I know this kind of thing goes on. You know, if you had some ideas or something along those lines, that would be helpful as well.
Okay, well, I could probably, I mean, I'm pretty good at getting people to talk. I wonder if I could, like, go there and just kind of meet up with Valerie and act like, Not tell her who I am, but just see if I could get her to, I don't know, see if I can get any information out of her, possibly.
Well, yeah, I would say don't do anything right now, Deborah, because we'll probably be out there. I'm guessing we usually book things a couple weeks out, so we'll probably be out there in a couple weeks. So I would say don't do anything.
There's a conversation that I had with Valerie. If you can get it from Mrs. Dyer, it was in the very beginning. I called and talked to her for about 45 minutes on the phone. And I acted like I was on her side, and I don't remember what all we talked about. That was a long time ago, but there's something in that conversation that might help. I did that for Mrs. Dyer. I just kind of called up and acted like, you know, kind of played on her side, and she was really open, and she told me a lot of stuff, but I just don't remember any of the details at this point.
Yeah,
but
yeah.
There is
do
a
you
conversation.
Want a tape conversation?
Yeah, I sure do, and there's even a conversation with there's a conversation also with Valerie and Charles that happened during the before the court hearing that she actually speaks of a bunch of stuff during this conversation between.
Yeah, I've heard that one alluded to, but I haven't actually gotten any conversations.
Oh, you haven't?
Like that? Oh, you know. So if you have something like that would be good to listen to as well.
Okay. So I'll send more conversations. I'm trying to think what else. I guess that's it. That probably is enough for now.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. What about the Boca? Have you heard about the Boca? It's like that bicycle gang that's out there in Oklahoma. They were actually
No,
asked, the prosecutor asked the Boca bikers to come to the first trial. And there was all these bikers that came, and it's bikers against child abuse or something like that. BACA, whatever it's called, what that stands for, is bikers against child abuse. Or anyhow, there was this overly like this, you know, tons of these bikers that were at the first trial, and maybe that might be something to, I don't know, go see what they have to say possibly while you're in Oklahoma. They work for the district attorney. I don't know what their whole deal is, but it's kind of strange that a DA would have, you know, this presence of all these bikers there, and you know, for the plaintiff side, it's kind of strange. But that's legitimate. Mrs. Dyer will even confirm that. And they were like, they kind of like roughed up Mrs. Dyer. They would walk by her and push her, and you know, just intimidated her and stuff during that whole first trial. So, and that was the DA.
So they're not friends of Charles.
No.
Yeah.
No, they're not.
Yeah, so I don't know how that would be helpful, but that's another odd thing.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. It's very strange for a district attorney to ask, you know, to ask these people, this biker gang, to come.
Did all the district attorney ask them?
Yes, the district attorney asked the BACA gang to come to the trial, and they came. The district attorney.
I'm saying, but how do you know that the district attorney asked them?
Well, I believe that Janet told me, the mother, but there's proof of it somewhere. I mean, this isn't like a hidden thing. It was either, there's probably somewhere an article, or I will find it for you. Mrs. Dyer, I'm sure, will be able to confirm how that went down. But yeah, this is the kind of tricks that Stevens County, Oklahoma, they play. They have these, you know, these strange, you know, situations. They even had, at the trial, they even had like the type of security that you would think a serial killer would have. They had the entire courthouse, all the roads around it completely blocked off. They had SWAT team on the roof of the courthouse. They had SWAT like all up and down the streets. They had, I mean, major high security at the very first trial, way overdone.
Yeah.
And then they had these bikers come in. I mean, it looked like something that, like Timothy McVeigh's trial. You know, really Timothy, like a terrorist kind of tone to it. It was just absolutely insane. There were police officers on every floor, armed Gestapo-looking SWAT all over the streets of Oklahoma downtown, you know, blocked off the entire area. Yeah, they're like, it was just crazy. And when they transported Charles from federal to state, when he just got found not guilty for his federal, they still had him completely bound up like he was a serial killer. They had a helicopter in the air following. They had patrol cars like all around his car following. They blocked the roads off to have him come through. I mean, really this whole like terrorist kind of, you know, treatment that it was just, it's crazy. Yeah. I mean,
that seems to be a common modus operandi now for law enforcement.
What, the terrorist?
Sure. I have my reasons why, but, that's a whole other subject.
Yeah.
So the primary evidence endeavor that you have is you're going to see if there's some, you can get a paper trail to
the money.
The FBI paying Rick Light.
Yes, that's correct.
Right.
Right.
Two or three payments, and then you've mentioned some other information.
Yeah, the list.
Some paid conversations.
Yeah. Right. The sheriff, the prosecutor. Possibly the one from Valerie, which is the wife. The letter for Charles, I'll get that to you. And then the gag order, and I guess the little violations that I wrote up, my rough draft. And I think that's it.
Okay.
I'll
send you a list of some of the people that I'd like to get contact information for that Amy hasn't been able to get, and see if maybe there's maybe one or two that you can maybe get for us.
Okay, cool.
Before we actually go out there, so.
All right, so if I talk to Charles tomorrow, if you think of anything else that Charles could help you with, like anyone that's a friend of his that he might, you know, that I might not know, or just, call me back and I'll be on the phone with him tomorrow, so that'll be a good day.
Okay. Yeah, I'd be curious to know if that was a flash drive with information against that DA Jason Hicks that he was holding up in that YouTube video.
Okay.
Because that was where I thought it was maybe the evidence that you were referring to as well on one of your YouTube
I'm thinking it might have been something different, because I think that was a different time the video was done. So he had some evidence. That's why I believe the feds burned his house down. That, I mean, I believe the FBI leveled his house to the ground. I think that was a total setup. Yeah, I think that's, and they got rid of all of his evidence he had. So that's what I believe. But I'll find out tomorrow when I talk to him.
It's certainly not out of the realm of possibility, that's for sure.
Right. Yeah, this is a crazy story, and it really is. Okay, well, I guess I'll get working on this morning, and I'm looking forward to meeting you. So I guess, Amy. Amy will be calling you, the sister. She's going to be calling you, I guess, probably sometime this afternoon, if that's all right.
Okay, yeah, that's fine. Sure.
Okay, cool. I'll talk to you soon. Thanks a bunch.
Okay, Deborah, thanks so much.
Bye-bye.